لا إله إلا الله لا
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونتوب إليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ولا إله غيره ولا رب سواه، أول بلا ابتداء دائم بلا انتهاء، لا يفنى ولا يبيد ولا يكون إلا ما يريد، لا تبلغه الأوهام ولا تدركه الأفهام ولا يشبهه الأنام، حي لا يموت قيوم لا ينام ولا ينبغي له أن ينام، ذلك بأنه على كل شيء قدير وكل شيء إليه فقير وكل أمر عليه يسير، لا يحتاج إلى شيء وليس كمثله شيء، وهو السميع البصير، هو الله الذي لا إله إلا هو عالم الغيب والشهادة، هو الرحمن الرحيم، هو الله الذي لا إله إلا هو الملك القدوس السلام المؤمن المهيمن العزيز الجبار المتكبر، سبحان الله عما يشركون، هو الله الخالق البارئ المصور له الأسماء الحسنى، يسبح له ما في السماوات والأرض وهو العزيز الحكيم، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله وصفيه وخليله وأمينه على وحيه ومبلغ الناس شرعاه، ما ترك خيرًا إلا دل الأمة عليه ولا شرًا إلا حذرها منه، فصلوات الله وسلامه وبركاته عليه وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كلام الله وأحسن الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار، ثم أما بعد. Indeed, the best of the words are the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the best of the guidance and the only accepted guidance in Islam is the guidance of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the worst of the matters are the newly invented matters in Islam, and every newly invented matter in Islam is an innovation, and every innovation will indeed misguide us, and every misguidance will take us to one destination, جهنم وساءت مصيرا أعاذنا الله إياكم منها قولوا آمين. أما بعد، my dear respected brothers and sisters, today I honestly want to talk about the importance of following the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, followed by a small portion of the khutbah of the importance of sadaqah. And the main lecture, inshallah, about giving and sadaqah will be tomorrow during the fundraiser that you see over there on that poster, inshallah, azza wa jal. Why talk about the importance of following the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Because a lot of people, they end up doing so many ibadat or so many actions in Islam that have no basis in the Quran or in the sunnah. And their intentions are pure. And they think that they are doing good, but they're not. And their basis of these ibadat is we have been doing it back home. Or we have seen people do it all over. Or are all these people wrong? Or is doing this ibadah wrong? The answer to that is yes. In Islam, in order for your ibadah to be accepted, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran sets two conditions for that. One, قَالَ فَمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُوا لِقَاءَ رَبِّهِ فَلْيَعْمَلْ عَمَلًا صَالِحًا وَلَا يُشْرِكْ بِعِبَادَةِ رَبِّهِ أَحَدًا. That whoever wants to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with accepted deeds, he shall do amalan saliha. If you read the books of tafsir, amalan saliha is all the actions that are followed by the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, that have a basis in the Quran or sunnah only. وَلَا يُشْرِكُ بِعِبَادَةِ رَبِّهِ أَحَدًا is to be sincere for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is what the ulama call it, al-ikhlas wal-mutaba'ah. Al-ikhlasu lillah, sincerity in this action for the sake of Allah alone, no one else. Al-mutaba'ah is your actions must have a basis in the Quran or sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Why this topic again? Because, especially in Ramadan, in Ramadan, a lot of people tend to come up with so much innovations and so much bid'ah. And you hear in every single khutbah, towards the beginning or the end of the introduction, the Imam would recite the hadith of Al-Irbad ibn Sariyah, إِنَّ كُلَّ مُحْدَثَةٍ بِدْعَةٍ وَكُلَّ بِدْعَةٍ ضَلَالَةٍ وَكُلَّ ضَلَالَةٍ فِي النَّارِ. That indeed, every newly invented matter in Islam is an innovation. And every, kulla means every innovation is a misguidance. There is no innovations that are good in Islam. And I'm going to talk about the bid'ah hasan in a second. There's no good innovations in Islam. وَكُلَّ ضَلَالَةٍ فِي النَّارِ. Every misguidance will take you to only one destination, in one place, that is Jahannam. وَسَاءَتْ مَصِيرًا. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم في حديث العرباض بن ساريه. العرباض بن ساريه كما في الترمذي وابي داود واحمد في المسند قال: وعظنا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم موعظه بليغه. That the Prophet gave us a very heart-touching advice. قال: وجلت منها القلوب وذرفت منها العيون. That our hearts started shaking and our eyes started tearing. Until we told him, كَأَنَّهَا مَوْعِظَةٌ مُوَدِّعٍ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. As if, O Prophet of Allah, this is your last advice to us. And the Prophet ﷺ tells the Sahaba, قَالَ إِنَّهُ مَنْ يَعِشْ مِنْكُمْ فَسَيَرَ خِلَافًا كَثِيرًا. He who lives amongst you after me will see so much differences and so much اختلافات and so much fitan. Now his sunnah alayhi salatu wasalam was to always mention the da, which is the problem, and then mention with the dawa, the cure for it. قال فعليكم بسنتي. Follow my sunnah. وسنه الخلفاء الراشدين. And the sunnah of these خلفاء الراشدين. المهديين من بعدي. And those who follow them after me. تمسكوا بها. Hold tight to the sunnah. وَعَضُّوا عَلَيْهَا بِالنَّوَاجِزِ. And bite on it with your wisdom teeth. وَإِيَّاكُمْ مُحْدَثَاتِ الْأُمُورِ. And beware of any newly invented matter in Islam. And when we say any newly invented matter in Islam, doesn't mean that you're going to come up with something completely different from Islam. It can be recitation of the Quran. It could be salah. It could be dhikr. It could be any type of ibadah that originally has a basis in Islam, but the way it is formed, or the way it is done, or the time it is done, or the amount it is done in, is an innovation. That is what the Sahaba and the Tabi'een and the A'imma after them were so, so specific and very, very strict about any bid'ah and about following the sunnah, to the point where one of them said, قَالَ وَاللَّهِ لَوِ اسْتَطَعْتَ أَنْ لَا تَحُكَّ شَعْرَكَ إِلَّا بِدَلِيلٍ فَافْعَلْ. Allahu Akbar. Says, if you are able, even your daily affairs, and he sets an example of scratching your hair, then do so. If you have an evidence for it. If you don't do it. To follow the sunnah. Some of the ulama mentioned, they said, if for example, right? Let's assume that your arm is itching right here, in the middle part of your arm. And there was a hadith that the Prophet would scratch his arm from the top to the bottom, as an example. And only that part itches. They said to follow the sunnah, scratch from the top to the bottom. You are doing two things. You're scratching the part that needs to be scratched, and you're following the sunnah of the Prophet. Look how strict they were. Abdullah ibn Umar, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, the son of Umar ibn Khattab, one day was walking by a Muslim, and that man sneezes. And when we sneeze, what do we say? Alhamdulillah. This man says, Alhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala Rasulillah. Now for anyone that would hear that, it sounds normal. Ibn Umar took stones from the ground and threw it at him. قَالَ مَا هَذَا وَاللَّهِ مَا هَكَذَا عَلَّمَنَا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ. What are you doing? He says, wallahi, the Prophet never taught us to say anything extra but Alhamdulillah. But those extra things that people add with good intentions. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قُلْ Tell them, Ya Muhammad, هَلْ نُنَبِّئُكُمْ بِالْأَخْسَرِينَ أَعْمَالًا. Should we tell you about those who will be a true loss يوم القيامة? They're going to lose يوم القيامة. They're going to go to Jahannam. Who are those people? قال الذين ضل سعيهم في الحياة الدنيا. Those who in this dunya they were misguided. How were they misguided? Read any book of tafsir, you'll find that they were doing bid'ah, Islamic innovations. Things that they thought were good. Allah says they were misguided. الذين ضل سعيهم في الحياة الدنيا. In what? وهم يحسبون أنهم يحسنون صنعا. But deep inside they think that they're doing something good. And that is the scariest thing about a bid'ah. Is a lot of people, they don't know that it is a bid'ah. They have good intentions. But we have a qa'idah, a rule in Islam. And I want all of us to know and memorize this rule or this principle by heart. In Arabic, it is al-aslu fil ibadat al-imtina' wa al-tawakuf hatta ya'tiya nassun aw dalil yubih. Wal-aslu fil adat al-ibaha حتى يأتي نص يمنع أو يحرم أو يحرم. In English translation means when it comes to any ibadah in Islam, any ibadah. And what is a ibadah? A very important definition of what is a ibadah. A ibadah, as the ulama define it, قالوا كل ما يقربك إلى الله سبحانه كل ما يحبه الله من الأقوال والأفعال الظاهرة والباطنة. That any act that Allah loves and that you are doing it to get reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A ibadah that you do expecting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to reward you for it. That is a call to ibadah. When it comes to any ibadah in Islam, any ibadah that you do to get the reward for, you are not to do any ibadah on your own unless Islam, please come forward, unless Islam tells you to do so. Unless the Quran says do this, do this, do that. Otherwise we are not to add anything else from our own. And al-aslu fil adat al-ibahati hatta ya'ti al-manah means when it comes to our daily affairs, things that you do on a regular basis. You wear clothes, you eat, you sleep, you go play. You are to do whatever it is that you want until Islam tells us not to do so. So you can eat whatever. Until Islam came and said we cannot eat pork, we cannot drink alcohol, and so on. You can dress whatever until Islam told men to not wear silk, to not wear gold, to cover your awrah, and so on. And the examples will go on and on when it comes to your daily affairs. So you can do whatever until Islam says not to. But when it comes to an ibadah, you are not to bring anything new from your own. And why again? Because sometimes in Ramadan people start thinking with emotions. They start thinking of some ways to gain these hasanat in this month of Ramadan with some new innovations and new bid'ah, and they forget the main fara'id and obligations that are prescribed upon them in the month of Ramadan. And you've had people that lack in their prayers and then go and say, Shaykh, let us get together and say Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar in a collective form, dhikr in a collective form. Well, let us sit together and make dua collectively. Well, let us sit together and read Quran collectively. All of this is a bid'ah in Islam, by the way. And when people are looking at me like, what are you saying? What are you saying, Ya Shaykh? I am telling you, if you can find any reference in the Quran, in the Sunnah, that any of the Sahaba or the Prophet ﷺ or the Tabi'een ever came together to do such ibadat, bring it over. But you will not. Go check all 10 major books of hadith that have over 80,000 or 90,000 hadith of the companions, and bring me one hadith that these companions were to get together and do things like this. And as you know, we call it in Urdu, I forgot the term for it, when people, you know, get together, for example, when someone dies and they get together in the masjid, each one holds a juzu and reads it.
سبحان الله أن لكم هذا ما لكم كيف تحكمون. There is no basis on that in Islam whatsoever. These are things, traditions that we brought from overseas. People have good intentions. People want to do good. But again, go bring a reference. And when I tell you bring a reference, a lot of times people get confused between what the Prophet did and what the companions did and what the Tabi'een did. You find a lot of these things that people do when you come and tell me, "Ya ikhwan, brothers, the Prophet did not do this." You see what, you know, Ali ibn Abi Talib did, or Ibn Mas'ud did, or Umar ibn Khattab did. You know, one time, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, radiallahu ta'ala, Hudayb ibn Yaman, one day he was having a conversation with the Tabi'een. The Tabi'een are the followers of the companions, who did not witness the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And these Tabi'een were bringing innovations to Islam. And Hudayb goes and tells him, he says, "What are you doing? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam never did this before." And they told him that Abu Bakr and Umar did. And you know what he told them? قَالَ وَاللَّهِ أَخْشَى أَن تُمْطَرَ عَلَيْكُمْ بِحِجَارَةٍ مِّنَ السَّمَاءِ وَاللَّهِ I fear that Allah may send down a rain of stones to kill you. قَالَ أَقُولُ لَكُمْ قَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ وَتَقُولُونَ قَالَ أَبُو بَكْرٍ وَعُمَرٍ I am telling you that the Prophet did not do it. And you dare tell me Abu Bakr and Umar did it? Look at this, subhanAllah. When it comes to the Prophet, Abu Bakr and Umar don't matter at this point. It's the Prophet or that's it. You only in Islam use the examples of the companions when the Quran and Sunnah did not speak about it. But if we tell you, or if someone tells you, the Prophet did this or did not do this, don't ever say, "Wallahi, you know, the Sahaba did this," or "My Imam Abu Hanifa," or "Malik," or "Shaykh Rahmah did this." Who are these people to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? كل يؤخذ من قوله ويرد إلا صاحب هذا القبر. Every individual on earth, his opinions and madhab are to be taken or rejected, except for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And sadly, we are in a time today where people, subhanallah, they glorify, and it is very sad, and it shows the level of ignorance that we have reached. Glorify their madhab or their imams more than the Sahaba and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You clearly say to them, "Ya akhi, the hadith says 1, 2, 3. The ayah says 4, 5, and 6. He says, "No, but you know our madhab." Then, "Ya akhi, forget your madhab. It's an ayah in the Quran or a hadith in the Sunnah. Don't bring any madhab. Don't tell me your sheikh did this or these people used to do that." A lot of times we bring these innovations to Islam where, wallahi, they will do nothing but harm you and misguide you from Jannah and guide you towards Jahannam. So be aware, brothers and sisters, of any newly invented matter in Islam. You know how many times in this masjid or in any other masjid that I've been to, how people come, you know, with innocence and sincerity. Say, "Shaykh, why don't we try to do this? Or why don't we read, you know, this surah a couple of times together? Or why don't we make this dua together?" I say, "Brother, it's not from the Sunnah." And they get shocked, like, "Wait a minute. Every year, back home in my country, we used to do it." Well, every year in your country, you were wrong. Now, you not knowing it's a different story. You're not accountable for it. But we have to be open-minded. That the deen, as the Sahaba mentioned, and the Tabi'een, "Ad-deenu qala Allahu, qala Rasulu, qala Sahabatu." The deen is what we take, is what Allah says, what the Prophet says, and if none of them do not mention it or speak about it, it is what the companions of Allah alayhi wa sallam did. قُلُوا مَا سَمِعْتُمْ وَأَسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ لِي وَلَكُمْ فَاسْتَغْفِرُوهُ إِنَّهُ هُوَ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ. الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله الأمين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. أما بعد, brothers and sisters, the time has finally come, that the time of the year where the sadaqat and the zakawat are either due in obligation of form as your zakat that have been in your account or in your bank or in your savings for a year, that it's time for you to give, or sadaqat that you take advantage of this blessed month of Ramadan where the a'mal are multiplied. Tomorrow, inshallah ta'ala, we will have a community iftar, so the adhan is around 8:10, I think. People have iftar inshallah together, men and women. We have food for enough people to come. So please, brothers and sisters, come all of you to attend this gathering of our community iftar. But it's not to come and eat and leave. The reasoning behind inshallah is we have our yearly and annual fundraiser dinner inshallah tomorrow right after iftar. Isha prayer will be delayed a little bit, but inshallah ta'ala we'll have iftar, then we'll start our fundraiser. So we do encourage and we ask everyone who has saved their money for this day to donate in Ramadan. Tomorrow is your day. So bring all your checkbooks, all your credit cards, and cash that you have. I remember, subhanAllah, last year I was doing a fundraiser in Ramadan at a masjid. And after we finished the fundraiser and everybody gave, you know, thousands and tens of thousands and 500 and so on, a little child, wallahi, he was like 5 or 6 years old. His parents raised him in the very best form. He came, walked from the very beginning of the masjid with a Ziploc bag filled with coins and told me, Shaykh, I've saved this from last year to give it to you today. SubhanAllah, that was the scene of that fundraiser. That he was saving every coin that he had to give it for next year's Ramadan. I'm not saying save for next year, I'm saying give what you have now and save next year inshallah. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to allow us to benefit the best from this blessed month of Ramadan and to be able to worship Allah in the best forms. Allahumma inna ala dhikrika wa shukrika wa husna ibadatik. Inna Allahu wa malaikata yusalluna ala nabi ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu sallu alayhi wa sallimu taslima. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد وبارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك نشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت نستغفرك ونتوب إليك. Don't pull me the salat if the brother finishes that aspect, inshallah.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Just like brother Yasir said, you know, just a small reminder we have over there on the wall regarding the tomorrow's fundraising. So I don't think anybody can miss that. This is the biggest banner we can have. So, you know, as a reminder, so please remember tomorrow, Saturday, iftar over here and fundraising. Bring your checkbooks, cash, wallets, you know, jewelry, whatever you want to bring. Also, car keys also, we take cars too. And also, we need some volunteers to serve the iftar tomorrow. So, whoever wants to help, please be here like 5:30 prayer with us. And then we'll have our plan how to serve the community because it's a tight place, there'll be a lot of people. So, we have to have a proper plan to accommodate everybody, inshallah. Also, our community, family iftar tonight. The family iftar tonight will be here, inshallah, part of iftar. So whoever wants to bring anything to share with everybody, please bring in 2 trays, one for women's side, one for men's side, so we don't have a kiosk and everybody has a taste of whatever you bring. So please bring in 2 separate trays for men's side and for women's side. Also, if you want to bring water, please do not bring the big bottle water. Bring the small 8-ounce bottles. You know, a lot of people, you know what they do, they drink 1 or 2 sip and then just the bottles on the floor. Last night, brother Yasir and I, we picked up like almost 20 bottles from the floor. And yeah, so as a proof, you know, they are sitting in the back, so you know, we have to throw them in the trash because we can't keep half bottles over here. So please, if you want to bring water, ask me, Brother Iftikhar and Brother Yasir, what we need, and we'll tell you what we can donate, as far as water, plates, or anything. So if you want to bring water, please bring small bottles. Also, inshallah, the next Friday, Baltimore County Police is doing the active shooting training over here, right after the second prayer, which is 2 o'clock. So please try to attend that. It is very, very beneficial, and we need to know, you know, what, how to react in case of emergency. So please try to attend that next tomorrow also. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I'll see you tonight for iftar and also see you tomorrow for the fundraising. Assalamu alaikum.